fear the reaper, nor do the wind, the sun, or the rain. We can be like they are. Come on, baby, don't fear the reaper. Baby, take my hand.
All right, we're going to have Michael Hoffman on with us for the next 2 hours. He's been gracious enough to move back 20 minutes because of the Palfrey murder. He'll be with us 20 minutes into overdrive. I want to take our time here today and attempt to not throw in my points and added things and back up what he's saying, but really riveting, important information to understand the world we live in and how the nature of reality has been hidden from us and false images and false maps have been downloaded into our minds. He is an alternative historian, award-winning, a former AP writer based in New York. He's written some books that have been bestsellers, very well received. And we're going to break down a whole host of issues, the cornucopia. I want to start at the beginning today and go back to the roots of this, go through it all with our guest today. Thank you for coming on with us, Mr. Hoffman.
Thank you, Alex.
This is a short segment. We're coming back in a long one, but just begin wherever you like, whatever you think's most important. If you were talking to a new audience, which most of my listeners are for you, and trying to explain it to a informed population, but also people that may not have a full understanding.
Well, I think I'd like to go back to what we discussed last time. You raised an issue, and then I heard a commercial on the program that set off something in my mind. And you mentioned, you said, where is it? Who's responsible? Where do we trace this cryptocracy, this conspiracy up to the top? And you said, is it a German conspiracy? And then there was an add-on saying that we were headed to a papal America, that whenever church and state are united, that brings about tyranny.
Is it a Zionist? Is it a young?
Yeah. When I hear that, I realize that there's more confusion out there than I even realized, because I think we have to follow a trail in the West. And what my remarks today will be about Western civilization, the cryptocracy as it operates in the West.
Now, I want to be clear. I want to stop you, though. I don't have confusion about this. We're all broken, though, into subgroups fighting over which group runs it, with most of our collective energies in the movement spent on that. I don't do that. You don't do that. I understand it's a methodology that infects all the major groups, but with some core groups operating. I just want to be clear for the audience.
Well, you know, I see that when we're trying to find a way of ameliorating the cancer plague, and one of the ways that the system keeps us from doing that is they plant the idea that everything causes cancer, so why bother? When we're dealing with the assassination of President Kennedy and we're trying to bring the criminal masterminds who were behind that to justice, one of the ways they obstruct us is they plant the idea that everybody killed Kennedy. It was the communists, it was the anti-communists, it was the CIA, it was the KGB. So when we have these agents of confusion sowing this, some of it is honest confusion, of course. Not everyone is an agent. But when the agents of disinformation or confusion are out there, we can't begin to proceed from first principles. And I find so many people are in difficulty because they're not proceeding from first principles. So for me, the first principle is...
Or let me just add before we go into this, or there are people deliberately putting out disinfo. Like some of the Catholics run it all crowd. They demand that I have on their grand poobah, but I've researched what he says. It's just made up. He believes that Rosicrucians use magic to drop A-bombs. He believes the Earth is on a string and that the universe orbits it. I mean, these people, some of them are so kooky, but they demand that you agree with them. And so I just want to be clear that I don't agree with a lot of the groups that are out there saying this group or that group runs it all. That's my point.
I see. Well,
go ahead.
And by the way, who are you referring to when you say the grand poobah of the Catholics?
Well, no, of the Catholics run it all crowd. I don't even want to say his name. It's just, I don't even think most of his minions know that he believes all this insanity.
Right, because one of the things I noticed in the ad is they said they created a proprietary relationship between church and state and the papacy. And actually, the United States of America was formed in revolt against an Anglican church and state, which had united in Great Britain.
Well, let's be clear. I don't endorse the ads on this network unless you hear my voice endorsing it. I have no control over that. But go ahead.
Well, and so, I mean, just very briefly, the Anglicans were operating a union between church and state. And one of the reasons I know that is when I was researching the biography of the first Roman Catholic Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, Roger B. Taney, And he talked about when he was a child, he was banned from going to Catholic school. He was born just slightly before the onset of the American Revolution. And once the American Revolution was a success, almost immediately, his parents were allowed to send him to the school of his choice. So it's just one example of the anomalies of history, and either we're
Stay there. We're going to talk during the break, and then we're going to continue on the other side. Stay with me. Now, I don't want to make this too confusing from the start. You can talk about whatever group you want. Say what you truly believe. Feel free to say whatever you want, Mr. Hoffman. I want to be clear about that. But I was confused in the last segment, and I didn't know about ads, and then it clicked in my mind about some Catholics run it all ad that, you know, runs on the network. And of course, I'm not a Catholic. I'm not a Catholic apologist. I just think it's exaggerated their power. I think they're part of the New World Order like every other big thing. But, let me just get some kind of idea, and this is on air right now. Because I haven't had done a pre-interview with you. I don't really do those. Tell me what it is you want to cover in the 2 hours we've got.
Well, I would like to cover my main thesis right now. I'm just finishing up. I'm indexing a nearly 1,000-page book on Judaism called Judaism Discovered. And so, obviously, that would be the source and focus of what I want to talk about today, although I realize I've written other books, and I know you're interested in the epistemology of the cryptocracy as I've elucidated it in my book, Secret Societies and Psychological Warfare.
And that's the system they use, and my only point is that school of thought is used by others, though you could argue they're the masters in the you know, preeminent group, you know, the strand that binds it all. And so I'd like to hear your view and your research on that. With 2 hours, then let's just get into the Judaism first for an hour, and then let's do an hour on all of their different methods and sorceries.
Right, and the other thing I'd like to say to you, Alex, is feel free to challenge me if you think that there's something I'm saying that's erroneous. I find that it makes for a much more interesting conversation.
Oh, don't worry. I'm going to have to physically restrain myself not to add points and jump in. But I have to tell you, sir, I have researched stuff you're putting out, the information you're putting out, and I think on the whole it's accurate, only because I'm somewhat of a history buff in my own right. It's so wide and you know, deep that, you know, we're all novices, really, but I've just found so much of what I've read you've written that I already discovered separately in multiple other texts that weren't even political in nature. So I have to agree with your overall view and analysis. I may disagree in the approach to the public, and also I believe that the globalists are also controlling much of the anti-Judaism movement and putting it out in a way that actually only empowers some of the more dangerous varieties there. And of course, you know, the old European tool of using some of the Zionists as their fronts before it was known as Zionist, you know, going back 1,000 years ago. So I believe it's kind of a hybrid amalgamation. But listen, you've got the floor. We're going live right now.
Yeah.
Here we go. Well, here we go. Here we go, sir. Every move the New World Order makes, every breath they take, we'll be there. Covering every subject, every issue, going to the Veritas, trying to find the truth, trying to question the box within a box that we all live in. All right, Michael Hoffman is our guest. Michael, before we go any further, tell us in a nutshell a little bit about yourself, your awakening for a minute or two, your websites, your books, and then we're going to go for 2 hours pretty much straight here with only a few breaks. Go ahead.
The website is www.revisionisthistory.org, and we're located in North Idaho, P.O. Box 849, Coeur d'Alene, Idaho, 83816. I was fortunate enough to have been born to a revisionist historian grandfather. He was a lay historian. He wasn't a professional, but he had a great deal of skepticism about the mainline story of history. So I was basically sitting on his knee from a young age, hearing him talking about things like, for example, that Joseph P. Kennedy had stolen the election in 1960 for his son through the Chicago Mafia. And I was hearing this practically as a toddler, so I suppose I've been predestined for this line of inquiry, for being a skeptic, for always questioning and doubting, and as John Milton said in the 17th century, give me the right to know, to utter, and to argue freely according to conscience above all other liberties, and that's what I've tried to live and what I've tried to extend to others, Alex.
Now let me just throw out something here. It's become... thought crime to say that CO2 isn't deadly poison. to say that sodium chloride isn't deadly poison. It has become a thought crime to even question official stories, official history. But questioning Deborah Jean Palfrey's clear murder, when we now have another eerie flashback, DC Madam said, "I'll never want my life to end in suicide." She not only said that here on this show, in May 2007 for an interview for Carol Joyt, host of Q&A Cafe TV show, Palfrey faced criminal indictment for prostitution, but for Palfrey, one thing was crystal clear during the interview. She would not end her life by hanging herself, as Brandy Britton, one of her employers, had clearly murdered as well. "I don't want to be like her. I don't want to end up like that." So another source, we're questioning history. Within 1 hour of her being found, official story, open and shut, she committed suicide in the garage, hanging herself, absolute bull. So that's questioning history, and that now is a thought crime they want to arrest you for. So we have to stand up against this now, no matter how painful or how demonized we get, because even if you disagree with ideas you hear here, you need to fight for the right for people to say them and have them. Okay, Mr. Hoffman, go ahead.
Well, and this particular questionable death that you're referring to reminds me as far back as Secretary of Defense James Forrestal, who a lot of us believe was tossed out of a window, and they claimed that that was suicide. And, of course, the secrets and the knowledge that he was sitting on were absolutely cataclysmic in terms of what he might have or could have revealed. So they certainly have a long history of doing this, but I'm not privy to the details of this particular case. But lately, since the year 2000, I have been consumed with my research on Judaism and on Zionism and the Talmudic religion, because I feel that it's a key to understanding the cryptocracy as a whole. And during the break, you had mentioned to me that you also feel there are some aspects of anti-Judaism which are problematic, and I would agree with that insofar as I believe that the cryptocracy plants their own agence provocateur inside various groups, and then they take extreme positions which actually benefit Judaism. One of the prime ways that they benefit Judaism is whenever you have race hate injected into this discussion. Because
and that brings, and the Zionist documents going back 200 years say that it compacts their group, and then they feed on the lower Jews beneath them, and the Jews think that their leaders are taking care of them, when Israel admittedly has been caught doing bombings in Baghdad 60-something years ago, bombings in southern Spain, all of these things to drive Jews back to their homeland. So
Judaics are the first victims of Judaism.
Yes.
That's something that has to be understood, is that the freedom movement that I'm leading here with regard to Judaism is first an attempt to liberate individual Judaics from Judaism.
And so you disagree with the main line of the crazies that say Jews are really Neanderthals and crazies that go around stirring up trouble and making people look stupid that talk about this. You disagree. You're saying you don't believe they're inherently devil seed.
Yeah, this reptilian idea and all of that, what it really means is it means that Jesus Christ was wrong and that people can't be converted. If someone is inherently the seed of the devil, all you can do is exterminate them. You cannot convert them. So you can see the occult root to that, and you can see the black evil that's behind that.
Well, that's my point, is that you know, 15 years studying this, every time I met somebody who said it was the Jews, they were lying, backstabbing, crazy, lying scum who would always attack me. And then I'm like, my God, the people that believe this must be bad, because everybody I meet is like, but I guess they're provocateurs or crazies or losers who want to blame a group. But just because they're doing that doesn't mean this isn't a predatory group out of control.
Well, it's a predatory ideology which is out of control, but there's another factor here, and that is, who is a Jew? I mean, people run around calling themselves Jews, and in John chapter 8, Jesus said that they had as their father the father of lies. So why do we believe them? All of the genealogical records were destroyed when the Romans conquered Jerusalem in A.D. 70.
Titus.
So we only have the word of these rabbinic liars to say that they're descended from King David or Abraham. You and I may have more Abrahamic blood in our veins than they do, but my question and my challenge to them is, prove it. Prove that you're descended from Judah.
Well, so they've done the DNA test, and they know that about 82% of people claiming to be Jews are actually Central Eastern European Khazars. And that's, people call me all the time like they found some new secret. I remember reading that when I was 10 years old in mainline history.
Right. So what that also does, though, it's interesting because it absolves these interlopers from actually being the biblical Jews. They don't have any kind of a curse on them, although I believe even when we are talking about actual Israel, and certainly there is a remnant of Israel on the earth, as Scripture says, but that curse was only on the few generations there, the early generations that would have been implicated in the death of Christ. It certainly wouldn't correspond to any actual biological Jew who was alive today. But this racial issue, Alex, one of the things that we have to understand here is that the rabbis are very keen on keeping Judaics inside the ranks. So they have to use the Hitlers, the Nazis, and the haters to scare the Judaic people back into the fold of Judaism. Because one of the things that Judaism teaches in the Talmud is that no matter how nice, how good, how benevolent a Gentile is towards you, he's only doing it for ulterior, cynical motives. He can never really love you for yourself. And a corollary from that, if I may expand on this, is the idea that if someone attacks the Israeli government, if they say they're genocidal, they're instituting a Holocaust against the Palestinians, if they say, like Walt and Mersheimer do in their book on the Israeli lobby, that there's inordinate power and control of the United States government on the part of the Israeli lobby, the reaction of the main hardcore of Orthodox Judaism and Zionism is to say, you know, that's inherently anti-Semitic. You don't really have a valid point. What you're motivated by is hatred and bias towards us. And of course,
exactly. I mean, if you and people always say, well, I don't hate Jews. I just hate Zionists. But now those guys have all flipped and are saying, I do hate Jews. It is the Jews. And
well, then if they're saying that, Alex, they're falling right into the rabbi's trap. Because
I know. I've read the official documents they wrote where they said, isn't it wonderful? You know, we'll get people to persecute us. We'll even commit horrible crimes and let the Gentiles find out so they'll persecute us so we can then have our little slaves under us. And, you know, not letting Hitler kick the Jews out, saying, no, they have to come to Palestine. They've got to pay us money. One cow in Palestine is worth more than all the Jews in Germany. I mean, these sickening evil statements, these types of things. All I'm saying is it's a lot more sophisticated. Let me digress, and then we'll get back into this. Why is there such an obsession with Germanicness by the modern Zionist? Why do we see the Rothschilds funding different German institutes of eugenics? Why do we see them funding it now? Why are they intermarried with European Germanics? Why are they supporting Schwarzenegger wearing his Nazi belt buckle in public? I mean, certainly you see that there's a weird satanic wedding going on behind the scenes, or you disagree with that?
Well, I would say that there's some of that going on, but it's a complex issue because it's more behind the scenes, overtly in public. They have impressed upon the German people the mark of Cain, a hereditary stigma, which is a form of mental colonization. The Germans internalize this. They have one of the lowest birth rates and highest suicide rates.
And they did that to blacks, too, with the transatlantic slave trade.
Well, they did that.
They had them internalized that they weren't humans or they were bad. They were Cain or Ham, right?
Yeah, as we talked about in the last program, they gave them this notion that they were hereditary slaves, and that was a part of a taint there. I'm getting an echo on the line here all of a sudden. I don't know if that's just at my end or your.
We're not getting it on the network. Network, are you getting that hum?
Nope, nothing.
I'm not hearing anything, sir.
Okay, great. I'll just proceed then.
All right.
And so what I would say is that I see a cleavage between this idea that there is sort of a secret linkage between the Germanic elite and the elite of the cryptocracy.
Well, I mean, let me stop you right there. I mean, $80+ billion in the last 4 years from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation with Warren Buffett, and they're in Africa injecting them with HIV. They're poisoning them. They've been caught. It's in the documents. They've been caught carrying out eugenics. I mean, that I would call Hitler-esque. But if the Judaics run it, I guess they want all the blacks and Asians dead too, or what?
Well, that's a little bit outside my competence in terms of discussing this.
But I mean, that's what I'm saying, though, is that the Darwinistic view, the Francis Galton view. I mean, when I get to the bet, I mean, the head of the Human Genome Project, Dr. Watson, saying blacks basically weren't human. You know, he's a white guy, and he's running the Human Genome Project, running around saying blacks aren't human. I'm saying you know, I understand in the media and everywhere else we can see the Zionists, but I'm saying when I get into science and I get into foundations and I get into this, I mean, it's Hitlerian, it's eugenics. I'm saying I've really found that, and I've really found Zionists everywhere too. So what I'm saying,
right, but it's Hitlerian, but Hitler is an anomaly in terms of German civilization. It would be like saying that George Bush is a typical product of our American civilization.
No, but when I say Germanic, I don't mean even the German people. I'm talking about Germanic occultism. And I'm not attacking Germans. I'm saying that there is a relish. The eugenicists, the British eugenicists, Rothschild-funded eugenics institutions worship the Germanic form.
Well,
there's something else here. Is something more here is what I'm saying.
I don't see any larger role in the occult for the Germans than for any other of the European peoples.
But you know, Germanic means wider. I mean, Germanic is the main, you know, fulcrum in that entire region, even into northern France.
Well, they certainly always wanted to control the Germans, but prior to the rise of Hitler, Germany and German civilization was a paragon of the music of Bach and Beethoven and the great philosophy and the advances in religion and science.
Oh, yeah, I know.
Which we owe so much to the Germans.
Pharmacologicals, everything.
I mean, there is a role in the early Ordo Templi Orientis of the OTO. There is a German connection there, and there's a German connection to Skull and Bones. But if we were to talk about the British, and again, that wouldn't be an indictment of the
English.
Oh,
no, I'm saying the British are the absolute heart. I'm just saying, why do they, as a fetish, you know, get into the Guter Dammerung and all of that. Look, it doesn't matter. The point is,
well, you know, it's interesting though, Alex, because they say that people who are in the know tell me that when you go to these collection catalogs for Nazi memorabilia and Nazi relics, that the number of Judaic customers on there is astonishing.
No, that's
and perhaps you use the appropriate word. Perhaps it's a fetish.
Yeah, no, I'm really study this stuff. I really want the truth. And I'm just saying, I've knocked down the hidden doors. I've gone, burrowed into the deepest pits. And I mean, I find a bunch of weird druidic, don't even call it Germanic. I see all of Northern Europe and you know, Britannia as Germanic, Visigothian, whatever you want to call it. So I think when I use the term German, I'm not talking about the last, you know, Bismarckian Imperial Germany. But look, I digress. Just, you know what? I may even have to even go out of the room because this stuff gets me thinking so much. I'll just let you finish. Just go ahead.
Well, Hitler used a good luck symbol, the swastika, which prior to the rise of his regime was always universally associated with good luck. All it is a symbol of the sun in motion. You put a cross inside of a wheel, you knock four segments of it out, and it looks like a running man or an intimation of the sun. An early pagan symbol, always associated generically with good luck, and he twisted it into this horrible thing. I think in general there is a magnetic archetype associated with the Northern European model, both racially and in terms of some of the things that we see in our movies and culture, as far as these associations with the polar regions and with the sword and sorcery epics. So it wouldn't surprise me if at some level in the occult or heavy metal music, or even at the higher levels that you're insinuating are operant here, that they are mining that, so to speak. But what I can tell you from my own research, what my opinion is that far above that and far beyond that is the Kabbalah, the Talmud, and the veritable worship, not of the German or the Aryan or any archetype along those lines, but the worship of the Judaic male as personified by the rabbi, because Judaism does teach...
Oh, no, I mean, there's no doubt that Madonna and all of it, I mean, it's everywhere. The symbolism, no, it's dominant. I agree. Go ahead.
Madonna is a... I hesitate to use the word witch because of all of the inquisitorial connotations of that word, so I would call her a magician. And I would say that her recent 30-minute show in New York City had all the hallmarks of a Kabbalistic open-air ritual that was both broadcast on the Internet and also much to-do was made of it in New York
City.
Well,
she says it is. She says she's doing this. She's a chicken-necked coward is what she is. These people just radiate weakness, but go ahead.
And she's also a kind of a mirror image of a biblical figure because she calls herself Madonna, and I guess that's her birth name.
Jezebel.
But that's her actual identity would be Jezebel. But what we find is, for example, in Judaism, they say, well, you Gentiles can be saved and you can be part of the covenant if you become a Noahide. But actually, they're not talking about the biblical Noah any more than Madonna is a representative of the Blessed Virgin Mary. She's the exact opposite. And the Talmudic Noah is the exact opposite of the biblical Noah. So all these poor dupes and suckers who are joining Judaism, there's two ways to be a Gentile and join Judaism. One is through Holocaustianity and going down to the Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C., and believing everything that's there and believing that only one people on earth suffered a Holocaust. That's one inroad in. And the other way is through the Noahide. But you're not following the biblical Noah. You're following the Noah of the Talmud.
But also people that, quote, join it are only porch Masons or, you know, porch. That's what it goes back to Solomon. We'll be right back. Actually, we're going to skip this break for Infowars.com stream listeners. Go to that stream. You'll be able to hear this break. And then we'll come back for everybody else on the other side in 3 minutes. Okay, Mr. Hoffman, continue.
Yes, and so in the case of the Noahide and the Noah of the Talmud regards Noah as a drunk and a very unsavory character, and what you really have is you have a trap for Gentiles. They're going to, it's like the old story where Dracula couldn't enter your home unless you invited him
in. He has to trick you, yeah, to invite him in. But let me stop you there. Let's just, when we come back, start at the beginning so people understand this about how the Torah is different than the Talmud and the Zohar and all those, and how they're separate, because they're hearing this going, the Bible says Noah's good. They need to understand two separate deals. You got a Middle Eastern group, you got a European group that just picked up on things that Jews picked up in Babylon and, of course, in Egypt, and then try to explain that to people.
Yeah, good point.
But just go ahead for now, because we're going straight through.
Okay, well, did you want me to continue with the Noahide thing?
Go ahead on that, and then let's come back to the full audience and get in to the separation here. Go ahead.
All right, and you'll let me know when we're addressing the full audience.
Yeah, we'll be addressing in 2 minutes. Go ahead.
Okay. So basically, the Talmud is bringing people, it's using people to think. These poor Christian people who think, gosh, here's the holy blood of Israel flowing the veins of these rabbis, and I've got to get amalgamated with them, and the way to do that is to associate with this Noahide group. And then just like you ask Dracula, oh, won't you come into my home? And having done that, then he has a certain power over you. So you join the Noahide group, and whereas right now you and I are basically trying to expose these evils, but when you actually sign on for the evil, then of course you lose a certain amount of your volition and your cognition, and it's that much easier to snatch your soul and control you. And that's what the Noahide operation is. It has nothing to do with the scriptures whatsoever, but people don't understand that there's this mirror world operating in Judaism.
Well, sure. I mean, that's the Pastor Hagee, where in the final equation, Jesus isn't the Messiah, we're all bad, hail Israel, they are the God men.
Yeah, Rabbi Hagee and his Ku Klux Judaism are really, it's such a joke that you would laugh if you didn't feel like crying. I mean, you don't.
Well,
really,
I mean, I've seen him
do
on tape go, "I praise God every time a Palestinian child is shot because another devil has been dealt with." I mean, he is just such a little fake. And Jesus did not come to be the Messiah. He was a rebel against the Lord's people and was dealt with.
And yet,
but you know what? He was forced to pull that book.
Yeah, but can you imagine that John McCain maintains respectability even though he's allied with him with certain qualifications?
I know, it's incredible. We're going back live right now. Here we go. Okay. Be clear, though, about the separate groups. Like, you have the Torah, which is the Old Testament, which is literally 180 degrees from what comes later. I mean, let's start at the beginning here.
Yeah, well, you know, we're dealing with master deceivers, and so there's a counterfeit. We were talking about that at the commercial break, how there it's a mirror world, a mirror of the scripture, and a mirror of biblical patriarchs and biblical figures. And so we will hear Orthodox rabbis say, well, we're Torah true. We have to follow the Torah. We have the Torah. And in fact, the rabbis tell those who are part of Judaism, you can't understand the Bible without the mediation of our interpretation of it. Protestants don't seem to have a problem with that. They have a huge problem with the idea that the Pope claims to be a mediator of Scripture. But when the rabbis make that claim, they seem to be very apathetic about that. And I don't understand that. But anyhow, let's be clear about the Torah. When they say that they're Torah true, they mean that they're Talmud true, because there is the Torah Shebiktav, which is the written Torah, and the Torah Shebelpa, which is the oral Torah. The oral
and they say
law.
That is the real law, not the old law.
Well, yeah, what they say is there is a dual law, that Moses was given two laws on Mount Sinai, the oral law, which became the province of the rabbis, and which was only written down after Israel crucified its Messiah and then really became degenerate. Prior to that, it had been a toss-up which way they were going to go, and so they had never sufficiently lost the grace to commit this evil to writing.
Moses, when he actually went after him throwing the tablets, he was going after this group, is what a lot of people say.
Well, I certainly think that it must have started around the time of the golden calf.
Well, they were bringing back the Egyptian secret knowledge they'd found, and he was saying no. So it's that same group always running right next to the other.
Yes, as we mentioned the last broadcast, the Talmud says 10 measures of sorcery were given to the earth, 9 were given to Egypt, and 1 to the rest of humanity. So they certainly see Egypt as a source of magic and sorcery. Of course, officially they condemn Egypt, but actually, secretly, they have tapped into that power, and they actually pay obeisance to it.
And as you said last time you were on, or as the late Arthur C. Clarke said, a Texas Instruments calculator would be the highest order of magic to somebody just 200 years ago. So when we use the term magic sorcery, that's ways to manipulate populations, lie, spin things, and then they just package it in a bunch of mumbo jumbo. Go ahead.
Yeah, because leftist intellectuals could accuse us of mystifying the discussion by bringing in magic, but actually they're the ones who are mystifying when they refuse, when they use this agnosticism, to refuse to recognize how technology operates. And the last program I mentioned that Arthur C. Clarke his famous statement was that any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. So that's what we're talking about. We're talking about a science which even certain scientists have been able to cover up and mock and direct our attention away from by claiming, oh, that's just silly fairy tales, but it isn't. And Arthur C. Clarke, who was a pioneer and prophet of the satellites that we now have operating around our Earth and a key agent of the cryptocracy.
Yeah, he's the inventor of it. Go ahead.
So he's our source for that. So you see, Alex, we have this counterfeit. We have the Noahide covenant, but actually it has nothing to do with the biblical Noah. It's the Noah of the Talmud and of the post-Talmudic text.
Which is what the Torah tells us, is that this group will always have counterfeits. They're masters at doing that.
Sure. Revelation 2:9 talks about, I know them who say they are Jews and are not and are of the synagogue of Satan. So right there, we're being warned of a counterfeit. Jesus in the key book of John in chapter 8 talking about the counterfeit. And that's a key scene there in chapter 8 because it pertains directly to what we're dealing with now, where they say, we have Abraham's blood in our veins. We are the children of Abraham. And Jesus acknowledges their biological pedigree. But at the same time, he says, you can't have Abraham as your father.
Stay there. Hardcore news, cutting-edge information, truly sophisticated discussions and debates. You get it here. In this fourth hour, we're going to go 20 minutes more with our guest in overdrive, if you can do it. We're going to skip some of the network breaks so I can talk behind the scenes for PrisonPlanet.tv viewers and people listening to the streams at Infowars.com. You got to go to those audio streams, though, to be able to tune into it. Or you can miss out on it if you'd like. Mr. Hoffman, go ahead.
Well, one of the things that I think is important to understand, Alex, is that we need counterintelligence and we need to recruit among the Judaics themselves. And that's one of the reasons why I've been able to profit in my research has been that I have had Judaic informants inside the yeshivas and the kollels who assist me with my research, and I want to encourage that, and I wouldn't be able to benefit from the details they've given me if they thought that I was a racist hater. And it feeds into the rabbi's image of the Gentile and of the Christian if we in any way reinforce that image. Now, what I wanted to do was I wanted to give you the actual teaching that Talmudic children receive in Orthodox Judaism. This is a phrase that's repeated to them throughout their childhood, and I'll give it to you now. Halakha hi beyadoa shi asav sonai lel Yaakov. And translated, that means it is a given law. It is known that Esau hates Jacob. Now, they see themselves as Esau, and we are Jacob. And what they're being told from the time they're little children is that they are irrationally hated just because they are Judaic. Not because they mistreat the Palestinians, not because they have inordinate influence over Congress. Now, if we, in our information campaign, fulfill that stereotype, as so many people in the right wing, in the neo-Nazi movement, and even in the Arab world have done and are doing and are encouraged to do by agent provocateurs, we are then doing the work of the rabbis. Because we need to convert rabbis, and we need to convert Judaics. Judaics who are listening to me right now, Jesus loves you. He wants to free you from these burdens, this terrible yoke that the Talmudists have put upon you.
Well, it's the same thing like our government, and that's the same mindset. You can see the same paradigm, the same signature. The government's going to keep you safe from the terrorists. Really, the government's behind it. The government's going to take your rights to keep you safe. No, they're not keeping us safe. They're hurting us and sucking off of us. It's the same group with the leadership using their mind control system on their own people. I mean, you already said that twice, but I want to make that clear. Go ahead.
Well, because what they're saying is there is a racial war to the hilt, and it's irremediable. There's nothing that they can do to change their race, and therefore, since they describe all of us, or the majority of us, as being racial haters of them, you then have this chasm that can't be bridged. And so if we actually take that position, as so many in the past have, then we're shooting ourselves in the feet. So it's very, very important to understand that we're dealing here with an ideology, with a spiritual force. And, for example, this spiritual force, as you know on your program and have brought up many times, operates within Freemasonry, and they're the most blue-eyed, blonde-haired, Aryan Gentiles they can be. We have evil in every race and every nation, but because of the nature of the Talmud and the Kabbalah, that evil is centered on this notion of the racial supremacy of the Judaic as personified by the rabbi. Now,
which is in the Talmud, which is in the Zohar, which is in all the books, and then it's in Encyclopedia Judaica, but we're not supposed to talk about that.
And we're actually dealing with the source of racism in the world as a whole, because it's not in the Bible. And it certainly is not in Islam. Islam may have many problems and many errors, and there's no question about that. But Islam does not practice racism. This, the most searing and ferocious and savage racism on the earth today is the racism of the Talmud, and then it's practiced and implemented in the Zionist Israeli state.
Okay, stay there. Stay there. We're going to continue during the break. If you're an InfoWars listener, stay with us, and I will be right back.
It is a big idea.
Okay, now I want to debate with you a little bit here. There's no doubt it says all that and does that and it's wrong, but then I look at every culture, or even one African tribe across the river from the other, they'll say the other tribe is bad, we're the best, you know, they worship the snake god, we worship the monkey god, we're better, or we worship the water buffalo god. You've got, you know, groups are always, I mean, everybody says our team's the best, or, you know, folks from East Texas are better than North Texans. I mean, we're all tribal. I mean, everybody says the other group isn't human and deserves to die. I mean, that's what the Aztecs would say when they were wiping out, you know, neighboring native tribes with sacrifice. I mean, you're not making the claim, though, as some do, that all evil and all racism emanates out of one place, are you?
Well, what I would say is that this tribalism that you're talking about is part of human nature. Now, I'm a Christian, so I'm supposed to be unnatural. I mean, that's what a Christian is in the sense that, for example...
But you're saying out of the three major faiths that spring out of Abraham, you're saying the one that has the new text, the Zohar and the rest of it in the Talmud, that has codified these ideas, you're saying it comes from the Judaics.
Well, of course, I don't believe that Judaism springs from Abraham. I don't see it as an Abraham.
Okay, well, what was Moses then? You wouldn't call that Judaism. You would call that Israel.
No, that's not Judaism. Judaism didn't get started until this oral law was written down.
I understand.
That.
So what would you call him, an Israelite? What would you?
I would call him an Israelite, and I would say the only Old Testament religion on earth is Christianity.
Well, I agree with that. I mean, it's definitely the root, and then...
But okay. If we see that they have a patrimony to Abraham, then we're beginning to see through their distorted lens.
Well, like you said earlier, that thing they said is that Abraham's bad. Yeah, I mean, that's insane because...
That Noah's bad. No.
Yeah, but before that, you were saying what they say as kids about how they're the one group and they're against Abraham.
Well, they say that they are Jacob... And I may have misstated it.
I think that's what you did, yeah, because I always thought it was Jacob and then the Arabs of the other group. Okay, yeah, that's what I thought.
Yeah, they believe that they're Jacob and we're Esau, so I actually apologize for that. I got that mixed up. They see themselves as Jacob. We are Esau, and so we're doing this.
And then that's what got picked up with the transatlantic slave trade.
Well, that's part of coming from the Midrash and from the Guide of the Perplexed of Rabbi Moses Maimonides. The anti-black teaching is in those two documents, although you've got to get the uncensored version of the Guide of the Perplexed as translated by Shlomo Pines. If you get any other version, usually the racial material has been excised.
Yeah, okay. We're going to come back right now. We're going live. Stay with us.
Visit them online today at braintuner.com. That's braintuner, T-U-N-E-R.com.
Big Brother, mainstream media, government cover-ups. You want answers? Well, so does he. He's Alex Jones on the GCN Radio Network. And now, live from Austin, Texas, Alex Jones.
Our guest for the rest of this hour, into the next, we're going into overdrive today, is Michael Hoffman. He'll give out his website, some of his books, tell you how to get them before he leaves us. He can do it anytime he wishes. If he wants, we'll take calls later. We'll see if he wants to do that. But continuing, we were having a discussion on the InfoWars stream and for PrisonPlanet.tv viewers, and I asked you, I said, you know, don't you mean... you know, Jacob against Esau. You said, yes, you'd gotten that backwards earlier, probably with all my interrupting. So just continue wherever you'd like.
Yeah, the website is www.revisionisthistory.org. And yes, when I was translating Halakha Hibiota Ishi Esav Sona Eliakov, I actually transposed it incorrectly. The Judaics regard themselves, of course, as Jacob, and we are Esau, and they see this as a racial divide that can never be breached, and that's why they have this sense of immunity and entitlement that they're never wrong, they never have to apologize, they never commit war crimes, and any accusations along those lines are being fielded by latter-day Esau's against themselves as Jacob.
So that's kind of a codifying a psychopathic outlook.
It is. It's a religion which has the symptoms of psychopathology because they have delusions of grandeur as being the superior master race on earth, and they're also paranoid in that they have this incipient fear of opposition. And those are two symptoms, of course, of insanity.
But it's a self-fulfilling prophecy because it's an intelligent, you know, group that is getting a lot of power, and so there's going to be competition, and there is also going to be people fighting.
Well, it's constant warfare. Zionism, I usually append the word Zionism with war. It's war Zionism, and it's war to the hilt. And, of course, you see that on the West Bank with these settlers and their Talmudic philosophy of annihilating Amalek, which is what they refer to the Palestinians as Amalek. And, of course, in the Old Testament, Amalek was a people who were supposed to be exterminated. So they're actually calling for the extermination of the Palestinians. But once again, that's not, Alex, on an Old Testament basis, because, as you know, in the Old Testament, God says he did do away with Amalek. And he said, I will blot out its memory.
And he
forever.
Said also, kill their animals.
Yeah.
But see, how do you deal with that as a Christian? Because you've got the Old Testament, which Christians accept, and saying, yeah, go ahead and kill everybody when you take over this land. Kill them and their animals. But then modern, it's Talmudic, it's evil, it's bad, when they want to wipe everybody up.
Yeah, well, that's a good question. I do just want to say, however, that the modern use of Amalek shows the Talmudic nullification of Scripture, because God keeps his promises, and he said, I would blot out the memory of Amalek. True Christians today don't go around calling anybody Amalek, but the Talmudists do. And so they're actually contradicting the Old Testament. In terms of...
Oh, so God ended Amalek with an announcement.
Yeah, well, he ended it through his own power. And you challenged me with the idea of God taking out these nations in the Old Testament. Invariably, when a nation was destroyed in the Old Testament, it was a nation that was practicing sexual sin under occult auspices, and that will destroy us. It will destroy...
Yeah, Moloch, burning babies, jam.
Yeah, so that's what we're talking. We're not talking about any innocent nation of people that God simply picked on because his chosen people were coming along. Because if you really read the Old Testament, it's an indictment against the Israelites. And the great prophets who Jesus said from Abel to Zechariah were killed. They were killed for criticizing Israel and telling them that they were falling short. Just like today, if we try to say the same things, we become under attack. And another indicator, Alex, that the religion of Judaism is not an Old Testament religion. We were talking earlier about how they disparage Noah. They also disparage the prophet Isaiah. Now, how can you do that and be an Old Testament religion? This comes out in my book that I'll be finishing up soon called Judaism Discovered. The prophet Isaiah, as you know, criticized Israel. And so the Talmud says of Isaiah that he had unclean lips. And they say that Isaiah was killed and he got what he deserved. In fact, the Talmudic description of his death is that he was sawed with a saw that went right across his mouth to punish him for saying these terrible things about the Jews. Now, no biblical religion would ever side with the killers of Isaiah, but that's what Jesus identified them as. He said, you've been the killers of the prophets. And you've been the killers of the prophets historically, this ideology and the spirit that you embody. And that's what we're confronting in the Israeli state, and we're confronting among Orthodox Judaism today in the United States, where George Bush on April 15th, as all of his predecessors since Jimmy Carter did on Education Day USA, met with the Chabad Lubavitchers in the White House. He got his marching orders from them. He dedicated this nation to the phony Talmudic Noahide laws, under the rulership of their dead messiah, Menachem Mendel Schneerson. That's been going on since Jimmy Carter, the conservative Ronald Reagan, both Bushes. And
let me ask you, what do you think Carter's doing now, going over and saying it's apartheid and genocide and wrong and being barred from entry to Israel and things like that?
Well, I'd have to preface my remarks on Jimmy Carter by saying that I was very, very angry at that man at one time, particularly when he instituted the cooperation with Castro for the disastrous Mariel boat lift. I don't know if he has ever really done penance for that, because he unleashed from Castro's insane asylums and prisons the dregs of that island nation. They came over here, they raped, they murdered, and they plundered, and that is on Jimmy Carter's record. Now, all I can do is surmise, Alex, that he has had a change of heart, that he's one of the very rare people who has been at the top that knows he was implicated in sin and wrong and evil, and in his own way, he's trying to make up for that, and I think he's doing that in his trips to the Middle East. I think he's doing good work. His book on the apartheid system over there is wonderful. I don't agree with all of it. But this is a man who is trying to fashion in his own sort of stumbling way a type of Christian witness in his old age. And I'll tell you, I'll take that rather than nothing. And we see something similar happening with McNamara, the Secretary of Defense under Kennedy and Johnson, and he's
well. That's why the globalists a lot of times kill older globalists, because they do. Some people turn back, you know, kind of on the cross there at the last minute next to Christ. But expanding on that, and I do think he's doing it for good reasons, just from, you know, what I pick up, you know, his body language, listening to it, analyzing it, and it's not a hateful thing he's doing. He's doing it in a peaceable way. It's just that, again, everything you describe about Judaism, again, I see those similar excuses, those similar claims manifested in other cultures. This is obviously a dominant culture. I'm just wanting to add that, again, humans rationalize, come up with this same stuff across the board.
Oh, yeah, but see, we're all free to challenge all those people. We're free to challenge Reverend Wright when he makes these statements. We're free to challenge the Chinese on Tibet. But as soon as we do, we apply the same criterion to the Israelis and want to treat them equally as all other human beings who have both shortcomings and a good side and a bad side, suddenly we become Esau, they're Jacob, and it's Halakha Hibayota Shiesav Sonai Lel Yaakov. And that's a special situation that we're dealing with whenever we enter into the territory of these rabbis.
I think the source... Now, are you saying in all rabbinical sects you basically get the same thing? Or are there particular... Because, I mean, I know, you know, in certain neighborhoods in New York or in the Middle East, the new film about Bin Laden by Spurlock, he's just in Israel, and these rabbis start beating him up, calling him filth. You know, he's not allowed in the neighborhood. But then other rabbis run up and get him and say, no, that's a crazy group of people. Yeah, I mean, you know, like you have the one group of rabbis saying Israel shouldn't exist, which has got hundreds of thousands of people, Nutri Cardi and a few other groups. And then you've got other, there's also, from what I've seen, a few different brands of Zionism. I mean, you have the big dominant one, but then there's also some other ones. Or what's your take on that?
Yeah, well, that's a good question. I'm talking mainly about Orthodox Judaism because that, of course, was all the Judaism that existed on Earth until the Maskala, that's to say the Enlightenment, which coincides with the liberal Enlightenment in Europe at its height in the late 18th century. And prior to that, from the founding of Judaism after the oral traditions of men were committed to writing in the Mishnah and then later in the Gemara in the 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th centuries A.D., all you had was Orthodox Judaism. And then two branches, actually three, Reconstructionism, which is extremely liberal and almost not a factor here, but two main branches broke off, and that's the Reform branch, based on the Maskala or the Enlightenment, and the conservative branch, which tried to take a middle road between the two. And what that really means is, Alex, the majority of Judaics in America who are religious and who are following Judaism are Reform Judaics, and a lot of them have never seen the Talmud in their life.
But see, that's what I'm saying. Every Jew I know is just a friendly, nice person, and most of them don't even like the war, and they just feel persecuted because the news tells them they are, and for what their leaders do, they are getting some persecution because they individually haven't done anything. And see, that's my larger picture. I mean, in your massive study of this, you're probably one of the former scholars who honestly looks at it not from a bigoted view, but from a, you know, just a cold scientific perspective. What's the power structure, you know, in the pyramidal structure? I mean, what percentage of the elite of the Judaics really know what's going on? And then, you know, what are the substratas? What's the command structure?
Well, see, one of the doors into Judaism for Gentiles, I mentioned, was the Noahide laws and Holocaustianity.
I was about to say the fake Christian Zionists now seem to be one of the most dominant, virulent, vicious groups now.
Yeah, much to the scandalization of the gospel, because a whole generation of young people are now turned off to the Bible and Jesus Christ because they associate it with these bloodthirsty warmongers. But to get back to your question, the access route for these Reform Judaics, who are sort of just cultural Judaics, and they...
Tell you what, stay there. We got a break. We'll talk during the break about this. For the network, we'll be back in 4 minutes. Michael Hoffman is our guest. I want to thank all the listeners, all the affiliates, all of the sponsors, everybody. We'll be right back in 4 minutes for everybody else, for Infowars.com stream listeners and PrisonPlanet.tv members. You can continue to watch right now. Okay, Mr. Hoffman, please continue with the power structure.
Yeah, so the door, Alex, for these sort of agnostic, liberal, Judaic types that you say that you're familiar with, the door into the Talmud for them is through Zionism. because Zionism is actually the Talmud in action, even though the Israeli state was founded by communists and secularists.
So it's the modern political manifestation and the door for the secularists to enter back in.
Well, you have to use Moses Hess, and this will be in my book. And for those who subscribe to my newsletter, Revisionist History, they're already familiar with him because he is the person who took inside himself both the Talmud, Zionism, and communism. Karl Marx called him my communist rabbi. He was also the spiritual founder of Zionism before Herzl, and he was actually loyal to the Talmud. He's an incredible personality. Very important for people to study, to understand. He lived in the 1800s to understand how the 20th century came about and these evils were imposed on us. So that, because a listener can say, oh my gosh, Hoffman's trying to say that the road to the Talmud is through Zionism, but so many Israelis are secularists, they don't want to have anything to do with the Talmud. That's correct to a degree. It's a generalization, and there's some distortion there, because the Talmud, as we've been talking about from the outset, is inherently, ipso facto, prima facie, racist. And what does it share with Zionism? Prima facie, ipso facto, racist.
Now, see, I want to be clear. That's why this system is so perfectly designed to take over other political systems, because it takes from Egypt, it takes from Rome, it takes from Babylon, it takes from the Old Temple, it takes all of those intrigues, and then it takes the Crusade clashes and all of this, and then how to control your subgroup that thinks you're thinks you're taking care of them, how to stage events, how to do all of this. It's a tiny ruling cabal that does study human behavior and activity ruling over these people. Now, would you say that the political Zionists are in control now, or are some of these rabbis still in control? And if so, which group of rabbis?
Well, I would say the main political rabbinic power is associated with the Chabad Lubavitch, because they are the ones who've been more or less delegated to go out into the world, to not be so much the literary recluses and bookworms, to go out there and do missionary evangelism with Judaics who have lapsed in their religion, and also to act as the political point men with the various leaders of the United States government.
Oh, you ought to hear them on the Christian radio shows. It's the craziest stuff I ever heard.
Well, and I'd be happy to debate an Orthodox rabbi if you can arrange it, or one of these other Christian programs do. I'd be delighted to do that. I'd be also delighted to take telephone calls today. But the Chabad Lubavitchers are probably the most politically endowed, both in the former Soviet Union, Russian Federation, in the United States, and in Europe. Very powerful there. And when we're talking, all these neocons are talking about Islamic fundamentalism and the war on reason, and yet the Chabad Lubavitch and other allied rabbinic groups have tremendous political power. They're fanatic, they're fundamentalist, they're against the Enlightenment, they're against freedom, they're weaseling their way into Europe and the United States government, and yet whenever these guys with these myriad, dozens and dozens of books about how the Islamics are making war on our way of life and they're going to abridge our freedom of speech, I've had my freedom of speech and my freedom of press abridged countless times as the
result. Well, I mean, that's a joke. Al-Qaeda attacked us because they hate our freedom, and the government's taking all our freedoms. That's right, they're Al-Qaeda. We're going to go back live right now, sir, and I do want to get some into, you know, the Twilight communication, all their, you know, the forms of brainwashing.
Sure.
I'd like to get into that soon. Here we go. Now, let's get into, unless you have more you want to add about New World Order.
I just wanted to say www.revisionisthistory.org is our website, and I just wanted to finish one tail thought there, Alex, that the roots of Zionist racism are in the Talmud. So for people who claim that the secular Israelis and secular Zionism couldn't possibly have a religious motivation, if you look around to Bolshevik Russia and you see these circumcised Judaics who were inflicting this Holocaust on the Russian Orthodox Church and on Christians there, they weren't doing it out of simply atheistic motives. They were doing it out of a religious hate which had been inculcated in them in their youth. So you can be a secularist as you grow up, but if you always have this sort of cerebral nostalgia, and you see so many times these hyphenated Judaics, have you noticed them, where they'll say, well, I'm a Buddhist Jew or I'm an atheist Jew. Most of us, if we're Christians or we're Italians or we're Irish, and we go on to a different world, a different strata, we don't continue to maintain our original identification, but they do. So here, a lot of them, not all of them, of course. And so what we have here is we have a nationalistic connection which survives even a transmogrification into a new world of Buddha or Tibet or atheism. They still cling to a racial national identification with the Israeli state and with their people.
Now, there's no doubt, though, that Western Europeans had what they believed was a providence, what they believed was manifest destiny, and that they did use the Torah as an excuse to exterminate the Native Americans. So there we see something similar to what the Zionists are doing, or similar to what whites were doing with apartheid with that. So I just want to make the point.
I don't buy the idea that there was an extermination of the American Indians in New England. I think we'd have to take it century by century. Certainly when these Union generals at the end of the war between the states went out there and tried to make the Midwest safe for the railroads and the corporations, yes, there was oppression of the Indians and a lot of lying and a lot of disgusting things.
Well, look, I like Andrew Jackson, but I've also got some Native American in me, Comanche and Cherokee. So I also like Native Americans, and you know, it was humans. You could hire natives to kill natives, and it was huge battles. And people say, look at the Indian killer, the Native killer, Andrew Jackson, who I like, fought the New World Order. That was when it was 2-1, 3-1, 4-1, 5-1, 10-1, fighting the natives. It wasn't like they were shrinking violet wimps or something.
But the
point is, they did say it's our right to go and take over. It's ours. My point is, that is a human trait. I'm just being honed and focused and wicked and vicious through the Zionists. But I'm just saying, I want to again let us all recognize this in ourselves, that tribes do this to each other.
Well, that's true, but I think when we're associating Christianity with that and with the Torah, and I want all respect paid to the Torah and to the religion of Jesus Christ. Then I don't.
I'm not attacking that. I'm saying it was used in Manifest Destiny, was it not?
Well,
was it not cited?
Manifest Destiny being different from what the Christians who came to New England were practicing.
Oh, well, it was the Christians who freed the slaves. I understand that. I'm not saying Christians, so that's a. Stay there. We're going to talk during the break. You want to flesh that out? Go ahead, sir.
Puritans fought a war of survival in New England with the Indians, but they made many efforts to convert them. David Brainerd was one of those people that Jonathan Edwards praised. And in fact, if you go into what I think is really solving the...
But there were abuses in the name of the religion.
Absolutely, absolutely. Every one of us has to keep a humility about our own selves.
My whole point is, this is silly to, I mean, and I know you don't agree with that, to say that Jews are inherently evil. That's the point I'm trying to get at here, is I'm not saying it's not honed and focused and really dangerous and going on. I'm saying that this is a tribal manifestation put into a hyper-aggressive package.
Yes, and so many Judaics, as you pointed out from your own personal experience, are not affiliated with the Talmud, they're not affiliated with Judaism, but like you and I, it's easy to put a flag in their hand, give them a slogan, and sweep them along with the mob, and that's what's happening to them, because certainly as part of my campaign and my ministry, first and foremost is an outreach to the Judaic people. To liberate them so that they can be more part of the solution.
And then I'm sure you're familiar with the fact that you get attacked by some of the neo-Nazis that clothe themselves as more reasonable, claiming you're bad because you want to reach out. They're saying Jews are inherently evil.
Yeah, and there a lot of those people are almost completely insignificant. They had a higher profile in the past when you saw, for example, the Canadian Zionists were funding John Beatty, who was running the Canadian Nazi Party.
We've caught German intelligence running the Nazi groups, firebombing the poor Turks. Then they go, oh, we have to leave your borders open. You firebomb the Turks. It turns out it was German intel. They've had Nazis in Idaho, as you know, who really are being funded by rabbis out heiling Hitler. Exactly. That's what I'm saying.
The Aryan Nations in Idaho was one of the greatest FBI listening posts that had ever been established in the United States. Randy Weaver's family would be alive today had Randy not gone up to Aryan Nations. And the real history of Aryan Nations and how the media kept that alive and has really not come out. Maybe someday there will be a book on it.
Absolutely. Time for their coffee, thank you. Yeah, that's one problem with not having breaks is that I then can't even get my own stimulant here. All right, listen.
I can tell you just as a sideline, Alex, that Timothy McVeigh was up here in our neck of the woods, as you probably know, at the Shadow.
He was at gun shows here in Austin. He was everywhere creating that ledger. Go ahead.
Well, he was with the Kehoe boys, who were implicated in some of the murders where they were knocking off some of the witnesses of the Oklahoma City bombing.
Oh, yeah, and then you also had the bank robberies going on right out of Elohim City that it turned out, official news, Southern Poverty Law Center was running. Exactly.
Aryan Nations, neo-Nazi network, all these patsies, these buffoons, these child molesters, these gun runners, ex-cons, they were all being funneling into this movement. But at the last minute...
Stay there. You know what? Recap that now with the full audience. Here we go. We were just talking about how the main Nazi groups, I mean, in the British papers, in the U.S., caught over and over again, not just run, but founded by British intel, German intel, ADL connections, Southern Poverty Law Center. It's come out in official FBI documents. Funding and running Elohim City, the main Nazi compound in Oklahoma, tied in with the rabbis and the Aryan Nations, running it in Idaho, and Mr. Hoffman's up there. This has all come out in the news, but the average American doesn't understand. Again, they need Nazism. They need hatred of Jews so the controlling group can use the Jews as their slaves, as a subgroup. And then they get very sophisticated, but also very simple in a way. Elaborate on what you were just saying.
And also keeping Alex... Well, I'd like to continue that very good point you're making there. Also, keeping Judaic people who are inside Judaism and who could reveal so much, like some of these Muslims who get out of Islam and they're going around on speaking tours, we need to have converted former rabbis who are converted to Christ going around the country telling what they know. And
well, that's happened before, and they get killed pretty fast.
Well, you know, I'm a positive thinker. I believe that God is on our side, and as long as he's on our side, who can be against us?
Absolutely. If God be with us, who can be against us?
You got that right. So, yeah, we were talking about Timothy McVeigh being up here at the Shadows Motel in Spokane, Washington, and he was meeting with the Kehoe brothers who were implicated in knocking off some of the witnesses to the Oklahoma City bombing conspiracy. And when this information was presented to the federal judge... at the trial there, he ruled it out of evidence, irrelevant, absolutely, because they really didn't want to reveal the role of what you and I are talking about, or how they use these patsies, and they certainly have patsies on the left as well, the violent animal rights crusaders and...
Do you ever notice, yeah, provocateurs, do you ever notice how the groups that claim they're exposing Zionism, they just freak out, attack everybody else, cause fights, claim people have been kidnapped that haven't, just run around wildly. They've always got criminal backgrounds. They're being handled. They're being run. Whereas I'm saying, everybody come together. Everybody's human. Let's just not be tribal. Yeah, there's evil mafias. Let's, you know, I'm trying to tell listeners, empower yourselves. Take action. We can win. We can fight evil. Notice the other guys, they never do that. It's a key MO.
Right, and I think that the lesson of the New Testament, at least for me anyway, as a believer, is that you cannot be in contention with these things using carnal weapons. The system loves violence. They absolutely feed on it. And
well, that's why they stage terror attacks. I love these guys that call me, write me, you coward, filth. You're not calling for guns and shooting people. You're a coward. But they're posting on my website, then we catch them with the same IP posting, look at this guy threatening, I'm calling the government, and the government shows up at my office. But we know from the IP it's them. They're feds.
Yeah, they absolutely need this violence. They need it in the Arab and Muslim world. Unfortunately, the Muslims have a religion which is oriented towards using carnal weapons against their opponents, so it's much easier to manipulate Muslims than it is to manipulate Christians, although we have so few authentic Christians these days that I suppose in some ways it's become just as easy in either culture.
Well, are you kidding? A lot of these white Anglo, quote, Zionists, I mean, you'll hear them say, nuke all the Arabs, murder everyone, kill all their children, kill anyone who disagrees with the government and our holy jihad against the jihadis. They've lost all their soul. Don't you idiots know that if the government will nuke Muslims, they'll take your bank account? Don't you know they can kill, the videos, hundreds of them, of our troops shooting Iraqi children for fun and shooting dogs, and our citizens don't care about the Iraqi kids, they cry about the dogs, showing how far we've fallen. Doesn't the public know that if evil is allowed to be perpetrated against somebody else, it can happen to you? I mean, don't they understand how that works?
Yeah, there's definitely been a process of dehumanization, and as you say, if we're dehumanizing these other people, then we're simply setting ourselves up to be dehumanized as well.
Exactly. Think how big these hit teams are that are already here. They have hundreds of thousands of troops, and tens of thousands have been involved in massacres, and they just sit there on the side of the road in Baghdad shooting cars full of women and children falling out dead, laughing. I mean, it's not even at a checkpoint. They just say, watch this, playing Elvis music and shoot families and laugh.
And Blackwater, as you know, has been implicated in that. And the headline in our North Idaho newspaper was that Blackwater may open a chapter in North Idaho because we have a lot of retired policemen, firemen, and military up here. And, of course, I take my hat off to all genuine public servants who really have protected us from crime and things like that. But when you have that kind of military mentality where the government is right and they forget what George Washington and Thomas Jefferson argued for and shed their blood for, then you have these mercenary groups coming in, which is basically, as you know, what we're operating in the Middle East is a mercenary army.
Well, that's why day one, a private gets $30,000 a year, a sergeant gets $50,000, $60,000 a year, a colonel gets $1 million a year. It's unknown what the generals get, but they fly in hundreds of billions on giant pallets per year and publicly hand it out off record to the troops, but that's meant to corrupt them. That's meant to get them ready for clandestine black ops. And now they're not professional hitmen in some cases. They're so bloodthirsty that I've seen the reports in major papers, and I've seen video of it, where there'll be a mother walking with a child and they'll have a 50 cal at, you know, 500 yards, and they'll place bets on, can I shoot her in the head? And then her head will explode, and then the child, mother, falls over with the hand. You know, and then just spraying and shooting and taking puppies and murdering them. I mean, it's just like, death, evil, blah. I mean, that's mind control. And now I want to get into that because I want to take calls, but we can't just go for 10 hours here. I mean, you've done so many other subjects. In fact, let me punch your website up here in front of me. I mean, there's so many. I just had it up here on my browser. Let me find it.
And that's revisionisthistory.org.
Yeah, for some reason it's not in my browser. Punch it up here on the screen for me, guys. Because I want to go through different subjects now quickly that you also cover, not just one of the big subjects.
One of the things that you mentioned there, Alex, with that violence and the way that it does damage to Jesus Christ and the gospel, because obviously Satan does not want the gospel to spread, doesn't want people to be saved, is we have so many ministers and even Catholic priests, for that matter, who've become neocons, who are preaching this war doctrine. They're cheering on the massacres. And the people of the world look on this and they figure, well, these are the public spokesmen for Jesus Christ. This must be what Jesus Christ represents. And yet Jesus Christ said, love your enemies, do good to them that persecute you. And the only violence that is allowed to a Christian, it's not actually violence, but taking up of arms, is the police power that the Apostle Paul spoke about, that the ruler bears not the sword in vain to protect our borders, to protect our women from rape, to punish kidnappers. But we're not allowed, as we've done throughout history, as these secret agents have talked us into, where one Christian nation fights another Christian nation, and the minister gets up in one pulpit and says God's on our side, the other minister says he's on their side. You had Catholic priests holding masses for the French army, opposed to Spanish priests holding masses for their army. This is all a scandalization of the gospel, and it diminishes the stature of Jesus Christ in the world, and I think that's the most satanic aspect of all of these wars, that we have Christian ministers and priests and politicians implicated in their
But again, anything is going to be used throughout history. It always is. Okay, now I want to get into the regime of Queen Elizabeth I, ideological template for the Masonic Imperium and the intelligence agencies of the West, and how that ties into Twilight language, the command and control argot of the cryptocracy, the alchemical processing of humanity via psychodrama embedded in ritual crimes, which we just saw on a high satanic holy day with the murder of Jean Palfrey yesterday. Let's go through that before I go to calls. I want to cover this giant area.
I hope you don't want me to do it all in 10 minutes.
No, but I mean, let's get into it.
Yeah, well, with Queen Elizabeth, we briefly touched on her regime last time, and whenever, rule of thumb is, whenever you're looking for this occult technology, you want to begin with the intelligence agencies, because that's typically where they're harbored. And last time I was on your program, Alex, we talked about Dr. John Dee, astrologer royal to Queen Elizabeth I, and with Edward Kelly, he was involved in necromancy and an occult process called scrying. He was also a legitimate mathematician in his own right. And his code name, and this will send everybody into orbit when they hear what it was, his code name in the Elizabethan cryptocracy was 007. And this is the original paradigm of 007. In fact, people who are in the know on historians of intelligence agencies in the West have remarked upon the fact that the best, most efficient, treacherous, and deadliest of all the secret police forces in the West have been the British intelligence, MI5 and MI6, and along with Mossad, of course. And all the rest of them from the CIA and the KGB downward are just pale imitations compared to that. Well, why did they have this power and how did they get it? In this particular case, John Dee was very much a Kabbalist. He was fascinated with the Kabbalah. And last time we talked about how the Renaissance Roman Catholics and the Renaissance Anglicans began to import these Pharisaic ideas into Christendom when the Christians had done such a good job throughout the Middle Ages of keeping these ideas out, and then they entered in the Renaissance. And John Dee was obsessed with the Kabbalah. He felt it was the key to the very highest forms of magic and control of populations and nations. And so back in the 16th century, he made the very difficult journey out to Prague, where he saw Rabbi Judah Lowe. Now, I must say this is conjecture. I cannot absolutely document that he per se met with Judah Lowe. He was in occult Bohemia at that time. It would be very hard for me to believe that someone as well-connected as he was going into Prague and not meeting with Rabbi Judah Lowe. But so far, we have not gotten the smoking gun on the actual meeting itself, so I can't produce letters or diaries that attest to that. However, the key books which would have that information, they're not even extant in the British libraries. One of them has been burned up. You can see the copy, and it's been heavily burned. The others have been lost. But one thing we do know, and we need to go by what people practice. That was Jesus' rule of thumb. What are by their fruits, you'll know them. And so what are the fruits of John Dee? After he returned from Prague, he was filled with this Kabbalistic gnosis. So if he didn't actually meet with Rabbi Judah Lowe, who, by the way, is associated with the mystical golem, the idea of getting the brainless goyim, and getting that, which is what they call the other nations of the world, and getting them to march to your tune, that was actually a philosophical meme or virus of Rabbi Judah Lowe. So whether or not Dee actually met with him, he certainly picked up the virus and brought it back to Great Britain, where he invented the concept of British Israel, which was a secret teaching that the people of Europe were actually descended from the 10 tribes. Now, I actually tend to believe that there is something to that, and just because John Dee advocated it, or the Kabbalists and the rabbis were trying to twist or distort it.
And by the way, that then energizes much of the modern Nazism and those groups. They all believe that as well.
Well, I have found that most neo-Nazis are very dismissive of British Israel because they're dismissive of the Old Testament, as Adolf Hitler was. Adolf Hitler was basically convinced by the occultists that he dealt with in the Thule Society and the roots of the Thule Society that there was this Manichaean split between the Old Testament and the New Testament. It's the heresy of Marcion, where you believe that Jesus was a New Testament figure and that this terrible Yahweh was this demonic figure of the Old Testament. The big problem with that is that Jesus quotes the Old Testament numerous times. As
sure, and he
apostles.
Says, I'm here to fulfill the whole of the law.
Sure, yeah.
But, so I mean, let's go back, though. That's interesting. Tell me about, from your research, I mean, I've done my own, the type of occultism that Hitler was following.
Well, one of the key aspects of seeing how Hitler was controlled is when you see that when he had state power over the publications of Germany, there's two key indicators for me. Is one is the very best Talmud that had ever been published in Germany, the Talmud of Lazarus Goldschmidt, was published in Nazi Germany while Hitler was the supreme leader. It's a 12-volume series. The last book was published in 1936. Publication began in 1929, and Hitler did not interdict the publication of the Talmud. But even more telling than that is when Hitler had the focus of the Germanic peoples of the world on him and on his ideology, and he had a just a golden opportunity to teach people, what did he hold up for them to learn in terms of advising them about what the inner nature of Zionism, communism, and Judaism was? The protocols of the learned elders of Zion. Now, I don't want to get into debating the provenance of it, but, Alex, at the very least, we can say that it is very much in dispute. Now, whenever I say this, I get mail from people, and they're trying to prove to me that the protocols is real, and I say, look, whether it's real or it's not, and I personally do not believe that it is authentic, but whether it is or it's
not. Yeah, it's written in comic book fashion.
Exactly. And there are a couple of key points, because I believe the Russian secret police had a good handle. The Russians were probably among the very best students of the rabbis, and they understood rabbinic knowledge. To this day, the Russians are very alert to the Talmud. And to
well, they have the oldest Quran, too, and just shipped a golden copy to Saudi Arabia. So there, yeah, a lot of scholarship going on.
And so here Hitler holds up the protocols, has it reprinted, when one of the greatest German scholars of all time, Johann Andreas Eisenmenger, in 1700 had written a book, Entdecktes Judentum. And it was about Judaism. It was a two-volume master key into Judaism, which Samuel Wertheimer and Oppenheimer, the financiers of the Holy Roman Empire at that time, had that book suppressed. And Eisenmenger had studied with rabbis for 20 years before he wrote the book. And Hitler could have commissioned a republication of the book. And there's still more details in that. Most Germans are not interested in it. I haven't been able to get Germans very interested in it. Our publishing company came out with an English version of it. You can find it at Amazon.com under Traditions of the Jews by Eisenmenger. But it's a one-volume abridgment by a Huguenot minister named Stellen in the 18th century. It's not the complete book, but it's the best that we could do. But that's really the master key to Judaism. What does Hitler do? He reprints the protocols and ignores Eisenmenger. Of course, Eisenmenger was a pious Lutheran scholar. There was nothing racist about him, nothing that you or I would object to. It would have been a benefaction to humanity of the reprint of that book, and he didn't do it. It's just one of a number of factors that you can see in Hitler's outlook and his attitude of the extirpation and extrusion of the Judaics from Europe, which has been, I mean, he's really the original $6 million man for the state of Israel. If it wasn't for him, the Israeli state would have never come into being. It was as a result of sympathy after World War II.
Well, that massive persecution. But then I get people telling me Hitler wasn't into the occult. He was a nice guy. I mean, you could just look at the guy. But then all the speeches I've read, I've listened to old audio recordings and translations. I mean, and the things they did and the people they shook down and just all of it, to say that, you know, this is a good guy, it just shows the sickening delusional nature of so many people. Now, we've got the final segment of the main radio show. We're going to do about 20 minutes of overdrive. I really want to get into Twilight Language, the Sub Rosa Command and Control, our God of the cryptocracy. There is no doubt they're following this. There's no doubt they're pulling games and doing all sorts of bizarre things. I want to talk about that during this InfoWars.com segment.